Hi guys, welcome back to the Bike Cave, and today I have a quite interesting experiment to do on my bike, and I think that if you have already watched my last video, you may have been waiting for this one. Last time we discussed about material fatigue and how it affects the service life of most of our bike parts. I'm not going to get into the theory of fatigue again, so if you haven't watched my last video, you'll find the link in the description below. However, the main idea of how fatigue affects the life expectancy of the parts is that the more a part is stressed, the less load cycles is going to endure. So if we want a part to last longer, we should do something to lower the stresses that are applied due to our riding. This can be done either by riding smoother or on lower obstacles, or by actually modifying the geometry of the part. But let's apply this one to my new fork case study. Does different fork geometry also means that I should get a different fork? Probably yes, and as I told you last time, I could get a carbon fork that would probably solve my fatigue issue, as composites show excellent fatigue resistance. But they are too expensive and I don't want to hit such an expensive fork on the rocky terrains I usually ride. Maybe I'll switch to a carbon fork in the future, but for now I think that I can experiment a bit on the standard Jitsi fork, similar to what I had up to now, as I think that I have an interesting solution to my fatigue problem. Before I actually show you what I'm going to do, I think that it's a good idea to explain a bit about material stresses, as they will give you a better understanding of what I'm planning to do. So when we ride, we load our bike parts and the applied forces are the cause of stresses in the structure of each part. Stresses actually indicate the severity of the loading scenario for the specific part given its material properties and its geometry. Hence, the same loads may lead to different stresses for similar parts that may have different cross-section. In other words, if my steering tube had a bit thicker wall, the stresses would be a lot lower and consequently it could potentially last a lot longer considering its fatigue limit. However, I get it that the design of the Jitsi fork steering tube could not be different at the area that my fork snaps every time, as its outside diameter should be equal to 1 1/8 of an inch, and its inside diameter should be such that could be used to properly fit a standard star nut. So if Jitsi was to make a sturdier fork, they should probably ditch the star nut, make the holes a bit thicker, and integrate internal threading into the steering tube similar to what some of the carbon forks already have. But this would raise both the cost and the weight of the final product, and this might not be desirable by most of the riders who use such forks. On the other hand, I'm usually in the range of 80 to 85 kilos, and I think that a bit more weight at the steering tube wouldn't hurt my riding performance, and cost-wise, I have something in my mind that won't break the bank and could probably give me a much stronger and fatigue-resistant fork. So today I'm going to reinforce the inside wall of my steering tube with carbon fiber, and I'm going to show you how this will significantly lower the stresses on the area that the fatigue crack initiates every time I break my fork. Okay, first things first, and before I actually proceed to the application of this idea, let's run a set of virtual experiments by implementing finite element analysis on a simplified model of the steering tube I created on Fusion 360. So here is the actual model that includes the steering tube along with the headset bearings, the spacer I use, and a rough representation of a stem. Also, I've modeled the load as a force at the end of the stem to simulate the load that is applied when I land a gap. I know that I could model the problem a bit more detailed, including the top cap with the relevant bolt and star nut, but I think that once the stem is tightened up, the tension of the top cap is negligible compared to the magnitude of the loads that are transferred through the stem. Hence, I believe that this FEA model can be safely used to prove my concept of strengthening my fork using carbon fiber reinforcements inside the steering tube. So to prove my idea, before I actually mess with my brand new fork, I created two similar models, one with a carbon fiber reinforced steering tube and one with the stock dimensions of the steering tube, and I ran the relevant simulations. Observing the results of the stock steering tube, you can see that we actually get a stress concentration point at the same area that my previous fork snapped, and this shows me that both my FEA model is quite good and that my assumptions up to now may be correct. Keep in mind that I have almost randomly assigned the value of the applied load, and thus we are not going to focus on the resulting magnitude of the stresses, but these simulations give us a good idea of the difference between the stresses in each model. So checking out the stresses on the model with the reinforced steering tube, we can see that we still observe a stress concentration at the same area that was observed before, but given that the loading scenario is the same, the magnitude of the stresses is significantly lower than the stresses we had before we reinforced the inner wall of the steering tube. This means that the idea of reinforcing the inner wall of the steering tube could lead to lower stresses and hence to longer service life on my next fork. Disclaimer, I do know that at the time this video is being recorded, Fusion 360 cannot perform finite element analysis for composite materials, but I think that it's quite okay for the purpose of my experiment, as it showed me that there is a stress concentration area where my previous fork had snapped, and also it showed me that I can reinforce my stereo tube with a stronger material and get lower stresses at that area. Actually, this idea of reinforcing the stereo tube is an applied practice that is being done by most of the carbon fork manufacturers. However, they reinforce the internal part of the stereo tube with aluminum tubing. Nevertheless, I couldn't reinforce the outside of the stereo tube, as this would lead to a change of the external diameter of the fork. So having theoretically proved that reinforcing the internal face of my new fork stereo tube could lower the resultant stresses and thus significantly extend the fatigue life of my fork, it's time to proceed with the manufacturing part of this video. To do the actual carbon fiber layup to the inside of my fork stereo tube, I'm going to follow a technique that is industrially used for the manufacture of most of the tubular and closed cell parts, such as bike frames, forks and handlebars. The process that I'm going to apply is called bladder molding, and actually implies that a bladder is utilized to press the resin impregnated into reinforcements against the walls of a mold. In our case, the mold will be the internal wall of the stereo tube. To begin with, we have to make sure that the internal face is rough and free of any other residue before applying the resin impregnated carbon fiber reinforcements. To do so, I clean the internal face of the fork with a rotating wire brush, and then I use a bit of acetone to remove any oily residue from the inside of my fork. Then it was time to prepare the reinforcements, and this was quite tricky and it took me a couple of tries to get it right. So the plan was to internally reinforce my stereo tube with 3 plies of 3K carbon fiber braided sleeves, which would give me an estimated final thickness of 1.5 mm. To do that, I had to overlay the sleeves one over the other, and to do so, I used a cylindrical stock I had laying around so as to help me in that direction. So the process was to cut the sleeves to size and then to pull them over the mandrel. Note that after pulling each sleeve over the mandrel, I secured it with tape so as to be easier to overlay the next layers. Having prepared the reinforcements, it was time to start preparing the epoxy resin that is to be used for the infusion of the reinforcements. This is a quite viscous resin I already had laying around, and it's not ideal for that job, but I'm going to use it and make it work anyways. However, I may get a more proper epoxy resin system next time. Keep in mind that this is just an experiment, and be sure that if I like the result, I'm definitely going to do it again in the future for my next forks. After mixing the two parts of the epoxy resin as specified, I try to remove any bubbles from the resin by applying vacuum using my hand-activated vacuum pump. This took a while due to the higher viscosity of the resin, but after a while, most of the air bubbles had been raised to the surface of the resin. Then I dip the reinforcements into the jar, making sure that they will not get tangled by using a latex balloon as a core. Next, I push the reinforcements into the resin so as to make sure that they are well impregnated, and I applied vacuum once again so as to remove any air that it produced during the impregnation of the reinforcements. After that, it was time to prepare the impregnated reinforcements to get inserted into the stereo tube. And frankly, this was the most tricky part, as this is the moment that everything gets ready for the final bladder molding process. To do that, I used another cylindrical stock with a smaller diameter so as to push and lay up the reinforcements into the stereo tube. During that process, I tried to lay up the reinforcements inside the stereo tube as perfectly as possible, so as to avoid any wrinkles that could potentially compromise the final integrity of the reinforcements. However, I think that I was careful enough to get the result I wanted to have out of this experiment. Having the reinforcements in place, it was time to insert the bladder and a cap I designed and 3D printed for that purpose. The bladder was actually a party balloon, and you may have noticed it on my workbench during the whole preparation process. However, I didn't like it in the end, as it tends to stretch in a non-uniform way, and this might move the reinforcements a bit when I was pumping it up. Next time, I will definitely make a custom bladder tailored to the exact dimension so as to solve that issue. Next, and after making sure that everything was in place, I pumped the bladder inside the stereo tube up to 100 psi, and hopefully this was sufficient enough to push the reinforcements towards the inner walls of the stereo tube. Then it was time to let the resin set for a day. Also, to speed up the process, I used an electric blanket to keep everything quite warm, as aluminum is an excellent thermal conductor, and thus not keeping everything warm could slow down a bit the setting process, which is an exothermic reaction. Another issue that I had while I was trying to get everything to work as I was expecting them to work, was that after having mixed the epoxy resin buds, I had around 30 minutes of working time until it starts to gel and stop being as workable as in the beginning. This was a challenge that I had to work with, and try to get everything first time right. To do so, I had prepared almost everything in my mind, and frankly, I was quite surprised that everything worked out in the end. However, I'm quite sure that the next time I decide to try the same bike hack, I'll be much more prepared and I'll make my next fork even stronger. But let's get back to the next day and the fork is almost ready. I removed it from the electric blanket and I tried to remove the 3D printed top cap, but unfortunately, everything was fused together as I forgot to use any mold released to the outside of the stirrer tube. So I used my heat gun so as to make the 3D printed PLA a bit softer and finally remove it from the fork. After removing all the 3D printed parts I used for this process and the bladder from the inside of the stirrer tube, I sanded out any resin that had been dripped at the outside of the fork and the fork is ready to get fitted on my bike. But before proceeding with the actual fitting of the fork, let's discuss a bit about the aftertaste of this experimentation. First of all, it was very tricky and it took so much thought and preparation before I actually do it, mainly due to the fact that the resin has a very limited time frame to work with. However, I believe that it was totally worth it, as it allowed me to reinforce my fork where it needs, and I'm sure that next time I could do it much better, and this could probably result to a fork reinforced enough to have an almost infinite fatigue limit, at least considering the current loading scenario. Also, weight-wise, these 3 plies of reinforcements added just about 20 grams to my new fork, which isn't much at all. But let's get back to the fitting of the fork, and given that my GC race stem has a slant top cap, I had to cut it to size considering this feature. Up to now, I was just scoring the fork where it should be cut, and I was using a hacksaw to cut it to size, but this time I 3D printed a sleeve that helped me to cut it to size a bit easier and considerably more accurate. I will definitely use this one again in the future. The only tricky part was to fit the star nut inside the stirrer tube, as its internal diameter had been reduced due to the carbon fiber reinforcements. Normally I had plans to make a custom threaded insert to replace the star nut, but I did this one during some days off I had, and I didn't have access to any machine tool to machine one in size. However, I'll definitely do it the next time, as fitting a star nut was a nightmare. First of all, I couldn't use a new star nut, as its initial outside diameter was too large to fit into the reinforced stirrer tube, and I didn't want to delaminate the reinforcements by pushing the star nut too hard. So I decided to fit my old star nut, which had closed a bit, and it was a bit easier to fit inside the stirrer tube. It took me a while to get it straight, and after that, I used a bit of epoxy resin to make sure that the star nut will be secured in place, as its geometry had pushed so much that I didn't think that it could bite into the walls of the carbon fiber reinforcements. Finally, everything was fitted properly and my bike was once again ride ready. I ride this setup for the last month and I'm pretty happy and more confident knowing that my fork is a bit stronger than the stock GC fork. Hopefully this one will last a bit longer than my previous forks and be sure that I'm going to do the same bike hack to my next fork, trying to perfect this reinforcing method and eliminate the probability of a future fork to snap at the same point again. But if you got up to this point of the video, I'm very curious about your impressions about this bike hack. Could you try such a bike part modification on your bike? Please let me know in the comment section below. That's it for today guys, and I hope that you liked this one. This couple of videos on fatigue were something I was planning to make for quite a long time, but I was keep avoiding them. However, I think that now that I had this fork snap on camera, it was the perfect opportunity to create these two videos, and I hope you enjoyed them as much as I did creating them. Thank you so much for subscribing and watching, and until next time, have fun riding your bikes, and I can't wait to show you my next project.